Cole is for the Mariners. Our professional baseball team. Quest Field is for the Seahawks. Our professional football team. Right across the street from each other. Safeco has the retractable roof, and Quest Field has the fixed roof. On the hill, in between the two buildings, that red brick building up on the hill here, that's the Bank of America Columbia Center, the tallest building west of the Mississippi River at 76 stories. And the building just to the south of it, you see here with the, I call it the upside down pencil building, pointed top. That's the Smith Tower, built by O.C. Smith. That's the guy that started the Smith Corona Typewriter Company. Up until 1964, that was the tallest building in the West. It's only 36 stories high.
You can never have too much to cut away to.
Yeah, I heard you talking.
Yes, he is.
This is, that street is awesome.
Isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Woo.
For the next 2 days.
Yeah, you're gonna do the whole
live from Seattle, Washington, the Bell Harbor Conference Center. This is GnomeNext 5.0, sponsored by, you got my nose in there, didn't you? Sponsored by Microsoft, LoggerGnome.com, and Yahoo. I needed my mic with the flash.
We're here in Seattle for GnomeDex, and what is GnomeDex? Hey, it's Eric Rice. Eric, tell us, what is GnomeDex?
Where am I?
Well, GnomeDex is kind of like an RSS 2.0 feed, where the enclosures are interesting people. Like Eric and Clint. Hey, here's Clint Sharp. Clint, what is GnomeDex?
I don't know. It's oh, wait, what did Chris Perillo, it's a people aggregator. You're right. It is, Chris Perillo said, people aggregator.
Yeah. Here. Eric Rice wants the microphone.
All right. This is Eric Rice, ericrice.com. Should I do the Walter Cronkite thing? All right.
From Seattle, Washington, on behalf of, it's the hijacked rocket boom, I'm Eric Rice from ericrice.com. Amanda, back to you.
Well, there you go. That's just a sample of what you're going to see from the reports from GnomeDex. Okay.
I have exactly the same camera.
Isn't that great?
It's a beauty.
He does a little show every day on...
Who does?
I
you
do.
Do?
I do.
Yeah? On what?
On what?
A show on what?
It's on everything.
You're kidding me.
Yeah.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
And now, am I on?
Rolling.
Now it's a worldwide show.
I'm learning here now about the king of knowledge, where it says, the humble sage, by virtue of true knowledge, sees with equal vision.
He sees a cow, or he sees a dog, or a dog eater, or a sage with equal vision. Because it does, whatever he sees the same. Because he's pure at heart.
You know what? I'm going to take the book and I'll look at it,
okay?
And we're in town for a conference, and it's called GnomeDex. Do you know what GnomeDex is?
No, I don't know. What language is it?
It's English. Take a guess.
No, gnome means nom, and dex means an index. Index of all the names. Like they say in the Chinese, the 10,000 things arising from the one. That I would call GnomeDex.
Very good. I think we have a new definition for GnomeDex.
Yes, this is the Tao Te Ching definition.
Tao Te Ching!
Is that all right?
Yep.
It's all good.
You guys do that, I'm getting coffee.
All right.
Don't forget to get the girl.
Oh, yeah.
You know what? Seattle definitely knows that.
What's your name?
Heidi.
Heidi?
Katie.
Okay.
Thanks.
Stuff like this.
Okay, guys. I'm gonna get my.
A little bit too much.
Okay.
Yeah, why are we hanging out? You need to teach me. I need to learn. You live here.
I'm happy.
Cuando caliente el sol aquí en la playa, siento tu cuerpo vibrar cerca de mí y en tu palpitar tu sonrisa, en tu pelo, en tu pecho me ilumina cuando caliente el sol.
What I asked is that you please pay respect to, you know, not only our sponsors, but also, you know, Nomdex. Just make sure that people know that you did it here. That's a good thing. And the reason why is because of auto-discoverability, that if you're...
Oh, he's done.
So we disagree on things and we're still this is Dave Warner. Dave, go.
Hi.
Oh, hi.
I'm Andrew Neal.
Hi, Andrew.
Can you put that into a vision for how a workplace would operate that way and communicate one another?
Yeah, I'd love to. Yeah, I do. I have a vision for that. Because I've actually done it. It's not like, sort of like, I didn't know how it worked until we actually did it. The key concept is narrating your work. In other words, when you show up to work at a virtual workplace, it's just like showing up to work in a regular place. You know, you sort of like have, you check in, and you start typing, here's my to-do list for the day. You might go to your manager's outline and see what, you know, what's on tap for you in his view of what you do. And you might want to see what the other people in your work group are doing. The people who were narrating their work, who were well organized, who were more valuable to me as a manager than the people who never could tell you what they were working on. And you couldn't do a quick read.
Or if they're listening from here and they're chatting.
Some people were.
Yeah, stop listening if you're here.
And I really like working with those people. And the people who do.
Hey, it's Steve Gar. Yeah, I don't have my Marv Albert headset on. What are you doing?
Your
Marv Albert headset. No, it's not Motorola, so it's not Marv Albert. Wait, pick it up. Don't touch any cables.
Yeah, don't touch any cables. Cable touching is bad.
Well, just lost a feed.
That's because there is no feed.
No, their feed. It cut out dramatically. It's like there's.
Huh? This glass doesn't sound good, so okay. They can hear everything.
Wait, pretty much you want to impose my taste about my side on other people? Didn't I say that clearly about it?
Your tool, as you said, you just got in a couple days ago. Your tool is a blocking tool now.
Yeah.
Again, thank you for your patience. We're working on it feverishly. Some people are getting it, they're dropping, they're on, they're off. It's kind of like relationships in high school, if you will, if you remember. I don't know where that came from, quite honestly. I know it's been kind of intense, et cetera, et cetera. I'm going to hold off. PT was going to be demonstrating something. He's going to hold off right now and do this demonstration, really cool demonstration, a little later today. And we've got about 10 minutes or so, and then Dean will be coming up to...
Where is not a PR stunt?
They're all freaking out over there. Those are the Microsoft guys. They're freaking out.
Yes, and as you can see, the Microsoft guys are wearing Longhorn and Hart RSS. So this is very telling.
Everything you can see that.
Very telling. So anyway, about 10 minutes, you guys want to take a breather, try to get online, get something to drink, eat, take a rest or break, come back in a little while.
No? You're okay? Okay, you're okay. I scared him putting his arms down. Okay. Subscription is powerful. Think about the first time you met somebody who had a TiVo, and they had that glassy eye look. And you said, I'm never watching TV the same way again. Subscribe is like that. That's what Subscribe did when I stumbled into it, and it started affecting my web consumption habits. And candidly, you know, that's why we're here. We believe in Subscribe. We believe in Subscribe very deeply. We think there's a lot of richness. We think there's a lot of power there, candidly, for everybody involved, for developers, for users, for everybody. And if there's one thing that you take away from the rants and the jokes and the PowerPoints and the demos and everything else that we're doing right now, it's that in Longhorn, the next version of Windows, we are betting big on RSS. We're betting big on RSS for developers and end users. And here's why. We're betting this particular way because there aren't enough end users who see it and get it. It's not easy enough for them yet. And there are a bunch of developers doing great things, but we want more developers doing even more great things. When I say we're betting big on RSS, I really mean three things. Okay. First, I mean making sure that throughout Windows, the experiences for end users are RSS enabled. RSS is easy. Wouldn't it be great if you could just call someone and say, oh yeah, this RSS thing, it's easy. Second thing is providing a platform in Windows, an RSS platform, to make it easy for developers. I want to make it easy for developers to RSS enable everything. We want RSS is so powerful, I wanted more than just the browser and the aggregator. I want it everywhere. The third thing we're doing is we're trying to help RSS cover more scenarios than it does today. There are a lot of great things that I can do in RSS today. There are a lot of great things you can do in RSS today. There are some things that are just too hard. And we're going to show some extensions that we worked through for RSS. We've had discussions with Dave and a bunch of other folks. You'll see some demos. We think that those extensions are going to help RSS get even bigger and better than it is today. So where should we start? Let me start with what happened today. They think creatively, they think independently, they don't really worry about the boundaries, they're willing
exciting in more places. There are so many more uses. There's so much more goodness that can happen. And as I think podcasting is amazing because it's a specific instance. It's something very concrete that we can answer and say, hey, my life is better. Right? My life's better. My PC and my iPhone can do all this stuff. It can send you this way. And my life got better. I get it. I'm a specific example. And this is the right ground to go through and say, it's great to have one. Let's have a walk. What else can we do with this? And I'm happy to be here and say, look, here are these Lego pieces. Here are these construction blocks. What do you guys think? What can we make next? And at least I've got a great example. Again, it's the first. Go ahead.
John, I just think it's such an interesting contrast between Apple and Microsoft. Apple says about Microsoft has no taste, right? And I don't listen to that. I say that's a positive. Because this is an interesting contrast between Apple and Microsoft. I mean, my message for podcasting is anybody can do it. If you listen to my podcast, what do I do? I stick a microphone out the window when there's a thunderstorm going on, I talk over it. Do I do any editing? No. I just basically take whatever comes off the microphone and then upload that, and then that's what you get. And Microsoft and Windows gives you this installed base, which is just unbelievably huge. But the quality is going to be the quality of every man. It's going to be, poor taste, but it's going to be relevant to you because your brother or sister is going to do it, or your niece or nephew, or somebody personal, somebody that you know will be doing this. And there won't be, drive time as much as it will be, just exactly the people you want to hear from. Yeah. And of course, there's room for both approaches. They're both completely valid. The other one says, let's produce this stuff and it will be commercial. And, put up a bottle of water so we can see. There's your yin and your yang.
What's the commercialized aspect?
That's you.
What's the yang?
I don't want your behavior to describe what you think and what you're using.
Well, in many ways, this is the dream of someone who's been a broadcaster all his life. And it's not just limited to audio. It can be done in many ways, although I think the actual portability of headphones with sound is a very important part of it. But all my life, I've always wanted to broadcast. What were the limiting factors? Who owns the rights to the frequency? So who allows you to get on and actually distribute? So that is all about distribution, which is most businesses surrounding around distribution. At the same time. And those are the two limiting factors. They've just been blown away. It's gone. So if you want to do a podcast or a broadcast, whatever you want to call it, for a small environment for people who are in a hospital, which I used to do on a closed circuit system, or if you want to do it, try and reach 100 million people, that's all possible. If you just want to do something like the equivalent of an audio reading card, it's all valid. So for me, personally, this is the holy grail of removing your gating factors of bandwidth through the ether and time.
All right, well, enough of the softballs. How about, what did you actually say to Steve Jobs behind closed doors about the directory?
About the directory?
Yeah.
I said, please take our OPML file, and please provide your own when you're done building your directory. That's what I say to everyone who's interested in building a directory. They introduced me to the concept of OPML directories. I loved it immediately, because it was something I could actually do. It was really cut and paste. It's not all that hard. I spent a lot of time, and luckily there's this beautiful new tool that is coming that will enable it to be much easier for people to create an OPML file. That's what I spent a lot of my time on, just helping people get that up and running. But the whole point is, Jobs said, well, we think there are too many top-level categories. I said, well, that's your opinion, so I think you should
want to.
And I made that very clear.
Well, we got Dean here. Why don't we ask Dean? When Scoble, do you think Microsoft wants
this
to?
This is the longest period of time Scoble has ever held a
microphone. No change in subject, Dean. This is a question directed at you. I mean, do you understand what Adam is saying about directories? And, you know, do you want to do that? Do you want to get involved in that process? Or
and other acronyms, I don't know. I think publish and subscribe, well, that probably will eventually dawn on people. And once you understand that this is for everyone and that you can subscribe to other people's content that way and also create it, which is a very important part of it, who knows where that's going to go. But traditionally, the billion-dollar companies don't go away overnight. And certainly companies like Clear Channel will just dry up. So it'll be a game to see what happens. We'll see things become very popular, and we'll see popular things become unpopular.
I would say too, I would make sense of that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, no, but these are very funny. Anyway, I was talking to the guy out in the hall about this Snap something.
Snapstream.
Right, and I mean his story is so deep and compact. He's doing a desktop PBR, runs on a PC. And he asked, well, what do you think about using RSS for this? I said, sure, a TV network becomes an RSS feed, right? And that sort of is pretty simple, easy to understand. And then all of a sudden it dawns on you that the same thing happens there, the same awakening is available to them that is available to the news media, the news business. And then they woke up one day and found out that all the bloggers in the world were available on the same aggregator platform that their news was, and that they had to compete with us. And all of a sudden, and that was, I understand Steve was there when that moment came, and saw the look on their faces, and it wasn't really a very happy look. So, I mean, blogging and podcasting have pretty much the same effect, and it's exactly the same people. I mean, on both sides of the equation, it's the same people. Bloggers are podcasters, and big media is big media. And, you know, I don't think there's any question. Scoble was the guy who came up with this way of looking at it. It's like, podcasting and blogs are high nutrition content. It's real stuff. It's real people. So, like, when Steve Jobs said we're like Wayne's World, I think he got it wrong. Exactly the opposite. Wayne's World is like us. We're the real thing. Wayne's World is the fiction, you know? So, I mean, it's hard to compete when you're, like Adam said, you know, garbage in, garbage out, right? Whatever it is you put on a podcast, it sucks when it was broadcast, it sucks when it was on the podcast. You know, I think reality TV ought to be, like, real, you know? Real, yeah.
Robert, before you go to the next question, can you comment on what they just said about you?
High nutrition. Right?
Well, I was talking about, I Dave started to watch using my show. Search engine. Outside of the feed server technology,
right,
to bring me news, and that's purified sugar. You know, so if I do a search for the word Linux, yeah, it brings me back. It brings me all this good, interesting stuff about Linux, but it's purified. It doesn't bring me the random stuff that goes on in people's lives that actually is human and lets me build a relationship with them. You know, like the developer who had who lost their child, their newborn child, a month ago. Right? I would have never seen that if I was just searching on the word Linux, right? But now I have something human, an experience that I talk about here at conferences with people. Or everybody should make sure they see Julie Lee. You know, I would never have been able to meet people.
Way to satisfy everybody, because right now, the metadata in IP3, for example, is so limited. So, you know, I think, you know, media RSS is a great step. I encourage everybody to take a look at that. It's not difficult to implement. I don't know whether it's the answer to the problem, but we do need to have much better metadata, because the biggest thing that's going to happen when Apple comes out with iTunes 4.9 is there's going to be a flood of stuff. So the question is, will it affect all of us that are podcasters? The majority of us from day one, no, because there will be a flood of stuff. What's really happening with iTunes, of course, is that they're putting podcasting on the map. That's what's happening. I mean, it's been a very small group of people talking to themselves, like the early days of blogging. And now, if you turn on CNN or something like that, you know, and saying, so let's check and see what the blogs are saying. And so, you know, that's, you know, people do know what that works. So anyway, the metadata for these queries. I want to say one other thing, just because I got a microphone. It's a bit of perspective that comes out of the question previously asked. Just something to think about. Think about the levels of influence. Right now, Chris, you here, Chris Perlow?
Hi.
Hey, how many people do we have at the conference?
We're pushing 400.
Okay, so we got about 400 people at the conference. And we're all, you know, we're all coming to the family here, and it all sounds very important, and we're doing great stuff, but this is such a small number. But we do a lot of conferences at IT Conversations, and one of the things that I'm trying to work with on conference organizers, Chris Perlow is the one who gets it, is that the people in this room are a small fraction of the influence sphere of this event. The podcasts from this event will be heard not by 400 people or 4,000, it will be heard by probably 150 to 200,000 people.
More.
And so, more.
That's just if Engadget links to it.
Oh, yeah, right. we've got to consider when we do an event like this that the sphere of influence is much larger. But what we're looking at, even there, let's say it's a quarter or half a million, that's still a small number. Adam is talking about hitting the 100 million mark. That's when all of this really becomes mainstream. So I think you look at steps like Podshow, you look at things like iTunes getting onto the podcasting bandwagon, and we're looking then at really bumping this to those kinds of levels.
Yeah, you're shaking your head.
Yeah, I have no interest in 100 million people listening to what I have to say. If I ever say anything to interest in 100 million people, I'm really screwed.
No, it's 100 million people listening to a podcast, not to you.
Oh, okay. To be mainstream, you have to like take your soul and bleed it out. You have to go down the drain.
Yeah,
you can't be mainstream.
You don't
mean
that as value judgment.
Not
do
you
that. I'm
talking about the medium being mainstream, not any one individual. Because of course the beauty will still remain that we can talk to small audiences. The fact is that right now there is a barrier between a small creator, content creator, and that audience because they don't know that this intermediate medium exists.
Yeah, but you know, there's something about what you said there that I just totally don't support, is that validation comes from hundreds of millions of people, okay? There are plenty of things that are worth doing that never reach that kind of scale. There's plenty of them, right? I mean, I've said this to somebody that, you know, how many people have PhDs, right? Is it 100 million people? I don't think so. But yet we don't shut down the graduate schools, and we don't say that they're a failure. We still encourage people to get them because it's good to have people doing things, even if not everybody can do it.
I think I didn't explain myself properly there. What I'm saying is there are a small number of people at one end and a small number of people at the other end, and the problem is that the people at the other end may not know that the technology and opportunity exists. By making that technology mainstream, you don't say that everybody has to be big-time commercial success. You only have the universality. That's what I'm trying to do.
Okay, can I respond? Okay. What I've found in promoting this stuff, because I've kind of made it, not, you can hardly call it a career, I mean, I'm not even in it, but it's still something that I do, okay, I like to do, is I like to set the expectations lower and then overachieve, rather than always be thinking, well, we won't reach it until we get much better or bigger or whatever the So people ask me all the time, is RSS, a success? And I said, yeah, it's totally a success. Do you think it's going to be, how's it going to be mainstream? How's it going to get to be mainstream? I said, maybe it doesn't have to be mainstream. Why do you have to always be thinking that way? I just, yeah. I mean, the best football coach that I ever saw in the world was Bill Walsh, right? San Francisco 49ers. This guy changed the way I think about not just football, but business and every endeavor. He would always say how great the competitor is, how great his adversary is, how his team has all these problems, and whatnot. Really. That way, when he wins, if he loses, there's this great team. But if he wins, then he looks so much better.
Unfortunately, George Bush took that idea and
guys talk about is you talk a lot about the growth of podcasting, and talk a little bit about the importance of BitTorrent or similar peer-to-peer bandwidth sharing to the future growth of podcasting and RSS in general.
Well, it's huge for podcasting. I mean, BitTorrent is the solution. It has gained traction. The LibSync guys, I noticed this, that the BitTorrent module we find is actually being deployed. I always thought that I would be the one to deploy it. We find an extension, kind of like what Microsoft did today, an extension that allowed you to include BitTorrent objects inside of an RSS feed. And I thought it was like my doorman. It turns out it's a LibSync. Yeah, that they're doing it. And I was kind of blown away. So in other words, it's not a futuristic thing. It's done. It's being done. And it's salvation. It's nothing less than salvation. Let's just hope. I mean, are they supporting this in iTunes?
Not that I know of.
See, that's a mistake.
Yeah, I agree with you that I don't know if it's BitTorrent per se, and I'll tell you why. We totally need a peer-to-peer solution because the bandwidth it's just expensive. If you get it above a certain level, and that's all relative. But the reason why I personally held back a little bit is I felt that with what's going on right now with the Rockstar case and everything surrounding the MPAA and BitTorrent, I just didn't want to be pulled out as the poster child. He's using BitTorrent, therefore he's doing something illegal. So I think that if we can get past certain perceptual hurdles, it'll be very,
That's like your argument with Steve Jobs, right? That he should do his directory open. You should do it precisely because of that.
You're
not infringing application. You're completely in your right. That's what you should be doing. I'm going to tell you, like, do you sell Steve Jobs? Adam, do it.
The more people here use things like BitTorrent, the more it's legitimate. Yeah. Because it has legitimate uses and it needs to be done that way.
Yeah. Holy shit.
Podcasting is potentially a salvation for BitTorrent because it provides the mulch for a fair use scenario that the courts have already called.
No, it's not infringing. It's different from fair use. Fair use this is much stronger than fair use.
Right.
Non-infringing. They can't stop it. It's First Amendment.
I understand. Right. And the fair use provisions.
Fair use says I can use your stuff. Non-infringing says, hey, this is mine. You can't touch it.
What we're talking about is a political attack on BitTorrent.
Right.
And the ultimate solution to that is if we've got all these bits that are licensed appropriately
legal stuff by us,
as opposed to the RIAA, we're in business. So, my scenario is, if this doesn't get any better, we just name all our files from now on Westlane.
Alright, raise your hand if you're willing to sign up to Steve's protocol.
Raise your hand if you're willing to have a trade document for
me. Yeah, I see, that's why you're the smart brother, right?
Keith's in. So I wanted to address Dave's point about validation and the point about 100 million. I agree with Dave on validation. For me, it would be
No, because there's a productivity application here as well. Like, for example, a sales organization might produce just a memo in the form of a podcast, and then that gets distributed. I mean, people like to be informed audibly, not just in written. In fact, some people, I vastly prefer it. That's why podcasting works for me. So, and it's not a secret. The major companies know about this one. The major technology companies know about it. And I thought I would knock on doors thinking that I would turn them on to an idea they hadn't thought of. They're thinking about it. So you maybe not heard a lot of publicity about it because people don't have products ready for it yet. But that's coming.
Adam, you have time?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because when we were first talking about, we didn't have a name for podcasting. We talked about bundles of passion, I think is what we all kinds of work, shows, this, audio blog, podcasting was a great word for media to pick up and run with, not work very well, but I agree totally with Dave. Lectures are being done now on podcasts.
if you want to call it a show, that's fine. It's my.
But that's it. That's
yeah, exactly. So, but it's to me, it's really just about distribution. I happen to like to make shows, but that doesn't mean that that's the only way that it can be used or the only thing you should call it. I mean, it's we'll see more applications for the distribution that is podcasting that'll just blow everyone's mind. I mean, that's to me, that's very evident. Just in many ways, that's going to happen. Museum tours are being done through RSS enclosures. It's yeah, it's nothing to do with the actual word show as maybe has been used for the past 50 years of broadcast.
All right, Buzz, last question.
Steve, as I've been running around America, when I simply explain to people that this is learning on demand, they understand.
All right. So, do you have anything to say before we wrap this up?
Let's get one more.
He was having his hand up.
Hi, John Norman here. I think it's a total revolution in media and how we're looking at it. I think the audience...
We've already got millions and millions of users using RSS today. It's not a dream. It's not tomorrow's syndication. It's today's syndication. The people who publish, bloggers, any of us can reach that audience right now. An interesting thing is that, and I think Dave said it this morning, a lot of those people don't even know the letters RSS or XML, and they shouldn't have to. And I think some of the things we're seeing, again, today, show us that more and more, maybe people won't have to know about the letters, but how do we really make it easy for these consumers? They don't even know that they're using RSS. But something we've been seeing is a lot of people doing more and more with RSS than ever before. You know, alternative news and blogs, and we talked about that this morning. But we've been working on media RSS, and really feel that has a lot of promise. When you think about audio, video, and photos being sent through RSS the same way blog posts, it's really beginning to think beyond the post. And I think the challenge that we all have when we think about tomorrow's syndication is, how do we make a user experience that makes sense? If you subscribe to your Flickr feed today, and watch some Flickr stream coming by. It's like the guy from Microsoft showed this morning. It's presented like posts. So for those of us that create aggregators, how do we make aggregators that make an experience make more sense? Should there be film strips, thumbnail views, slideshows, like Dean showed this morning? I think all of us need to be thinking about how do we make the technology so it's that easy, that convenient, that integrated. And same with video, same with podcasters that we were just talking about. But ultimately, baking these things into the user experience where the user wants it. And to that point, I think one of the things I'm optimistic about is consumers have been asking us, you know, they say, I want what I want, where I want it, how I want it. They're actually beginning to say that. And a part of where they want it is off of the PC. You know, I think we need to think about where are these experiences that people are getting content? The idea of reading RSS on your mobile phone, there's a lot of great mobile RSS readers out there now. And we're seeing, you know, we launched one back in March. We're seeing a lot of movement around there, and we're beginning to play in the living room as well, thinking about how does that experience work and how can we stream RSS into the living room? Ultimately, that no matter where, you can get your content. And so some of the great stuff, Dave, I think you've been doing Technorati, it shouldn't just be in a reader either. It should be in context. So that the idea is you go to Salon or you go to Newsweek, and there's syndicated content from around the web right alongside the professionally produced, who knows what professionally produced is anymore, but professionally produced content on that site. So really, again, yeah. I tell you what I care about, give it to me where I want. Don't limit me to one device. Don't limit me to one website. Don't limit me to one application. And then lastly, give it to me how I want. And some of you may know that we just last week acquired a service called VLO.js. It was really about, and for those of you that don't know what that service does, it's a service that relays pings, that as soon as you publish a piece of content, it'll notify us and we'll notify everyone who's listening, aggregators all over the web, that content has been updated. If you really think about that, I think one of the most interesting trends that I think Dave and Steve were some of the first to talk about it, it's moving time web. The idea of a stream of information that the moment something changes, you can know about it. You know, the U.S. Geological Survey has an RSS feed, and there's been a lot of earthquakes in California. I'm from California. If they ping us, you know, we can alert you at the moment that something is happening. If you're going to be able to realize, people want content at the moment they want it. Some content maybe you read once in a while. Some content you want to know right away. Last night the Spurs won. You got to know that. Some people got to know that. you know, when that earthquake is happening, kind of be interesting if you're getting an SMS message the moment it's happening, mm-hmm. kind of explain why the ground's moving. But ultimately,
it's not your drinking.
It's not your drinking. Yeah. Especially after last night. So I think, you know, those are some of the things we're beginning to see, and I think with each of those, we've all made strides. I think there are many of you who have made products or have helped move those things forward. When we think about giving consumers the content that they want, no matter what type that is, no longer news and blogs, giving to them where they want it, not just on a PC, not just on a reader, and giving it to them however they want it, as fast as they want it. I think those are the trends that have been exciting to me.
Well, first off, Chris, thank you for inviting me and for having us all here today. And it's just an honor to be here with Steve and with Emma Scott. I think that, first of all, I was just bowled over by the Microsoft announcement. I think that's fantastic. And I honestly, you know, talk about earthquakes. I think we just saw one here this morning. You know, Dave Weiner came over to me afterwards, and he said, he certainly knew, he said, yeah, where's the press? And I was like, you're all here, right? And the fact is that you guys are all sitting on top of all this stuff. You're no longer just consumers, right? But you're producers. And, you know, and the fact is that the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal and all the other folks who aren't here, you know, to be part of all of this are going to be reading everything that you're writing. And that's what they're going to be basing their stories on. And I think that's huge. It's a seismic shift. And I think that, you know, thank you, Scott, for the nice comment about real-time web. But I really think that there's a fundamentally different way that we can start to look at the web, and we can start to think about, and not just the web, but the internet as a whole. And it's moving from thinking about the internet as the world's biggest library, right? Which is, this is the metaphor that we've all been taught to think about it. I mean, think about even the words that we use when we talk about the internet today, right? We talk about pages, and we talk about documents, and we talk about directories, right? And we talk about, you know, catalogs, right? And we, you know, stores. But it's like, you go, oh, well, gee, that's sort of the library model of, you know, there's all of these documents that are out there, all these pages that are out there that I can go out and I can get, right? And the fundamental problem with that is that, you know, there's really no deep understanding of, you know, how new things come into play, right? And since we're moving really into a world where I fundamentally believe that over this decade is going to be entirely about user-generated content and the rise of user-generated content, both in terms of production and in terms of consumption of that, as the tools themselves have gotten so much easier to allow average people to be able to create podcasts, right? To be able to write blogs, to be able to do all sorts of interesting things. And then on the other side is, you know, now to be able to consume. This is what was so remarkably cool for me about the Microsoft announcement today is, you know, for me, it, you know, how much is it going to change my personal life? I don't know, but the point is that, like, my mom is now going to be able to get all of this stuff because it's just going to come with her operating system. And I think that, so when you start to look at the fact that, okay, it's really, you can still think about the web in terms of a library. I mean, it's a perfectly valid way to think about the web, and it works really well for a lot of things. But the way that I like to think about the web is more of just this humongous river, right, or this event stream of just millions and millions and millions of state changes that are occurring at any given moment. And so to be able to then tap into all of those state changes and be able to track all of that stuff, you know, first of all, it means that you can be timely, as Scott was saying, right? But when you move beyond that, you can start to go, gosh, you know, it's not just about being timely, it's also about understanding fundamentally the concept of time as it applies to the web. Right? And what are some of the new kinds of applications that have never, ever even been thought of when you can start thinking about documents and pages, not just as documents and pages in the library, but you can start to think of them as people having conversations over time. Right? And how much more participatory we can be as we get more and more real time. Right? I mean, I want the web to be as real time as I am. And that's not the way that we tend to think about it. But I think there's some really interesting aspects to this that then sort of start to fall out of it, right? And I mean, that's not here today, and a little bit, right? And I think, you know, where you see it in the blogs and you see it with RSS is sort of the tip of the iceberg. I mean, I call it the symptom. You know, I think that this is symptomatic of some of the fundamental changes that we're going to continue to see over the next 3 to 5 years. Anybody who's going out any longer than that, you know, we're already smoking enough, right? But, you know, seriously, think about this. We're about 3 to 5 years out, right? You go, okay, well, how can we even add more structure, right? So that, you know, like the enclosure supports in RSS2, which was a wonderful generic way of being able to add additional types of metadata to an established standard. Or, you know, some of the new micro formats that have just come out. And if y'all haven't had the opportunity to do so, I would highly recommend that you go to microformats.org, which is an industry consortium, and Scott and the guys from Yahoo are involved in it, the guys from Google and the guys from Six Apart, and folks, you know, Brian Deere at the folks at EVDB and upcoming.org, and you know, a whole group, Techerani is part of it, you know, around how can we more effectively and clearly be able to express this kind of semi-structured data format, so that it's not just about, you know, an item, you know, a description and an item in a feed, but you can actually start to do things like, gee, what's a calendar event look like, right? And so there's actually some pretty simple stuff around, yeah, iCal is great, but when my mom clicks on iCal, she thinks it's an error message. And so, you know, but gosh, what if you could actually represent iCal as valid XHTML, I mean, one-to-one translation, and that's something called HCal. Now, gosh, well, we already have all these browsers that understand HTML. And hey, we have things like CSS that allow you to take this format and be able to show it as a nice little calendar event. And you know, it's this kind of very simple, human-oriented metadata formats that I think, you know, you've got to give huge props to, you know, to Dave Weiner and to, you know, to for focusing on keep it simple, stupid.